Welcome to CAPES CFE Classroom. In our today's session, we'll be learning a new concept called consumer fraud. Consumer fraud is a fraud which is very, very frequent these days. And the success rate of these kind of fraud is much higher than you can imagine. As per one survey, every time you receive a junk mail or called a phishing mail, the success rate is 1 out of 10. Now you can imagine how successful these consumer frauds are actually happening in the market. So let's try to understand what kind of consumer frauds are there in the market and how we can prevent ourselves and our near ones with these frauds. Let's start with first kind of scheme called con scheme. A con scheme is a scheme where the consumers are actually conned. They are actually getting into a trap. The con is planning to sell them some kind of fictitious product or services which may not actually exist. So there are different variations of con schemes in the market. The first kind of scheme is called advance fee swindlers. Advance fee swindlers are those who collect the advance fee on pretext of either giving some kind of loan or on some other giving some kind of product or services. Once they collect advance fee, you will never ever get the product or a service which was actually promised for this. The advance fee swindler will take away all your advance fee and will be vanishing. So that's first type of scheme called advance fee swindlers. The next kind of scheme here we can discuss about is called debt consolidation. Many times you may have read the newspaper ads where people pose them as to be credit doctors. Or they say that they can help you improving your credit rating. Trust me, all this are part of consumer frauds. It's very difficult or it's almost impossible for a third person to get your credit rating improved. So debt consolidation schemes may be those schemes where the customer has been promised that this mediator, the supposedly a con, will help you out with the debt consolidation. He wants to collect some money from you and he promises this amount will be passed on to your creditor or banker. Once this amount is deposited with the bank, bank will help in the consolidation of your debts. Or they might give you some kind of holiday period where you are not supposed to pay your EMIs or the interest. All this comes under debt consolidation schemes. The matter of fact is that money will never ever be actually going to the creditors. The mediator in between will collect all the money and will be running away with this. We call that debt consolidation schemes. Once we understand this kind of scheme, there are different variations in the market. Another scheme which is related to your education. So cons have not spared your education part as well. Here comes a scheme called diploma mills. Lot of type of diploma mills are there. Let's talk about first kind of scheme. The college or the institute would ask for advance fee for processing your application for certain degree or diploma program. The money will be collected, but actually you will not be admitted for any degree or diploma. The second variation, you deposit the fee, you get into a particular course for degree or diploma or certification, and after some time you come to know that all those degrees were fake. We call them diploma mills. There may be a situation where you get yourself admitted in a particular university or institute. And afterwards, you come to know that there is no university or institute as such. It was all on papers. So all these are part of diploma mill schemes. So these schemes are those where the fees has been collected from students, but never a diploma or degree is given to the candidate. That's called diploma mill scheme. Then comes the modeling school. As the name suggests, the con will ask you to give some kind of money for the portfolio so that your modeling photograph or portfolio can be prepared. Once the money has been collected, you will never ever get a call for the modeling school scheme. Then comes revenge scheme. Once this happens to customer, customer really get angry and they want to take revenge. Suddenly somebody will come. Equity skimming scheme. Equity skimming is a scheme where the loan has been taken on your property without your knowledge. So a con will come in between and the loan will be applied on your property and you never wanted this loan. We call that equity skimming scheme. That scheme is very, very common in a lot of towns. Then comes block hustle. Block hustle is a scheme where some kind of antique jewelry or art item will be sold to you at very, very high prices. There are a lot of art lovers in the market who wants to pay a really high amount for the art and the antique things, provided it is genuine. The thing which is being actually sold by con is not genuine. It is all fake. We call that block hustle. Then let's target the senior citizens. It's relatively easier to target senior citizens. So there's a scheme called pigeon drop. Pigeon drop scheme is a scheme where particular senior citizen will be contacted. They'll be told that they have won certain lottery or there is some kind of lost will in their name. All they have to do is they have to deposit some amount with the lawyer. Because once this amount is deposited with lawyer, lawyer will help with this procedure getting that will amount. The senior citizens will be putting some money with the lawyer and matter of fact that lawyer is part of the con scheme. We call that pigeon drop scheme. Then come bank examiner swindler. Again, the main target may be senior citizens or old age people, where person will be posing himself or herself as a bank examiner. They may say that particular insurance policy or in particular bank account, they were supposed to get more money, but they have actually not got it. So this con, who's posing as a bank examiner, will helping them out getting those money. That's called bank examiner swindler scheme. The person in between is not a bank's examiner, but he is actually a con. So that's another variation of con scheme. Then comes a scheme which is very, very common these days, is telemarketing. Every now and then we all get some kind of telemarketing calls. But again, the success rate for these telemarketing calls are really, really high, more than what we can imagine. What generally happens, they have a different kind of people who are associated or involved in the scheme. The first layer is called boiler rooms. The boiler rooms are having different kind of people called fronters. So fronters are those people who are the front face of the company. They may be telecallers who will be contacting the customer first and will be telling them about their product or services. There are higher chances the fronter may not be involved in the scheme, in the sense they would not even know what they are part of. So most of the time fronters are innocent people who have been just put in as a front line, but they may not actually be knowing what they are selling and how exactly their company is cheating to the customer. So that comes the fronters. Fronters, post fronters, there is another layer called closers. So closers are veteran people. They know with their pressure technique, their sales technique, how to close the deal. So once this fronters have convinced the customer to the first level, the call goes to the closers. Then closer will close the deal. They will use their high marketing techniques to close the deal and convince the customer. And finally, you get a call from verifier. When you genuinely buy a product or service, you get a verification call. In this scheme also, you will get a verification call so that you will not get suspicious. So there are fronters, there are closers, and there are verifiers. Everything looks so genuine that there are higher chances that most of the customer will think it was a genuine product or a sale. It was fake, you will only come to know after some time, when you will never receive the product or service which was promised. These days, a lot of variation of telemarketing frauds are there in the market. Some could be for products, some could be for services, some could be for club membership, some kind of holidays, what you have won, and so on. So all these are part of con schemes. Now, once we understood all the basic type of con scheme, let's talk about two main schemes which are very, very common and trust me, very, very successful in the market. The first kind of scheme is called Ponzi, and the second scheme which we'll be discussing is called pyramid scheme. Let's discuss the Ponzi scheme first. Many times you may have heard people saying, give me 100 rupees or give me $1, I'll make it double in another 2 months. And so on. Lot of marketing companies, lot of so-called financial institutes are selling such a product where you've been promised an extraordinary return on your money. This may be part of Ponzi scheme. A Ponzi scheme is a scheme where your money has been invested in certain schemes and your extraordinary returns are promised to you. But end of the day, what you are getting, maybe initially you will get some amount out of it, but what you are getting is not the return, it's the distribution of capital. Let me just simplify this process. There are three people, person A, person B and person C. So this Ponzi scheme company has approached all three customers, A, B and C. Let's say A was approached first. A deposited $100 with the company. And company promised to pay the $200 within 3 months' time. Now the question arises, how will company make it double in 3 months? That's almost impossible with any of the scheme available in the market. Let's see, the A got convinced with the scheme. In order to repay A, to make him quiet for some time, they will approach another customer called B. B has again deposited $100. So this $100 from B will be given to A now. So A has got $200 within 3 months as promised. A is very happy. Now comes B. B was also promised the same amount, $200 within 3 months. Now next customer is C. C also deposited $100 and now B was paid out of C's money. I hope now we understand what is called Ponzi scheme. So here the distribution, what is happening is not of return which is being generated on the capital, but it's a distribution of capital itself. That sign of Ponzi scheme. So please, when you invest your money, be very careful. Whenever the company promises extraordinary return, be watchful to it. You should know how market is moving, how your economy is moving. If economy is in the downward trend, if market is in the downward trend, how on earth your particular company is going to make your money double? Or how will they promise you extraordinary return? As an investor, you have all the right to know in and out of your investment. Where will they put their money? How that particular industry is performing? So suppose a bank says or a financial institute approach to you and say that they're going to put your money in certain mutual funds. Ideally, you should ask what kind of mutual fund they're going to put your money in. Will they be investing in real estate industry or manufacturing industry or banking industry or where? If they are saying that, okay, we're going to put your money in real estate, then please Google and find out about real estate industry as to how is it moving. If real estate industry is not moving properly or is not going upward, how will your money be doubled? Or how will they give you the extraordinary return? Because whole industry is having a downward trend. So that's, as an investor, we should be careful. Do not get lured with extraordinary returns. That may be part of Ponzi scheme. Once we understand the Ponzi scheme, let's try to understand pyramid scheme. Pyramid is nothing but MLM. Most of us are aware of what is MLM. Now let's try to understand another scheme called MLM. MLM stands for multi-level marketing. This particular model has nothing wrong. In fact, this is very, very good business model. So how MLM actually works? Let me just explain it. There is a product called a cosmetic cream. So a company is selling a cosmetic cream. You are a customer, you use that product and you really liked it. So the company wants you to refer it to your known affinity. your circle, your friends, your relatives. If you refer to another customer, you will be getting a reference amount. Once the layer next to you, they will also use the product, they will also like it, they will refer to one more layer. And once the third layer will buy it, both you and the level below, both will be getting paid. This particular model is called MLM, multi-level marketing. As I said, it's a very good business model. So when the pyramid becomes illegal pyramid, the pyramid becomes illegal pyramid when majority of the revenue of companies coming from reference, not from the sale of product and services. So let's take a thumb rule. Ideally, 80% of the revenue of company should be from sale of product and services, and about 20% should come from the reference. When it goes vice versa, 80% of revenue is generating through reference and 20% is generating through sale of product and services, we may call it illegal pyramid. What's the problem involved in illegal pyramid? There may be possibility that companies not having any genuine product or services. All they are making money is on reference. So you refer to the another is referring to another, and so on. So this is how the circle is moving. That's called illegal pyramid. Now let's compare Ponzi and pyramid. Both seems similar. Both are fake, both are part of fraud. All pyramid schemes, illegal pyramid schemes, are actually Ponzi schemes also. Extraordinary return. So the only difference between Ponzi and illegal pyramid is, in Ponzi scheme, the front is return, investment, where in illegal pyramid, the front is product or service. So company is basically referring to a particular product or services as a front when it comes to illegal pyramid, whereas in Ponzi scheme, they use some kind of investment schemes and that's a front. But end of the day, matter of fact is both are illegal and fraud schemes. So now I hope that we are pretty clear about the schemes called pyramid and Ponzi scheme. Once we understand that, there is a last kind of scheme which is there in the consumer fraud called identity theft. Identity theft is a very common scheme, especially when it comes to US. Now it's growing in other parts of the world as well. Identity theft is a theft scheme where your identity is stolen. So if you are in the US and you have a social security number, somebody steals the social security number and misuses it. He or she may get the credit card done, take the loans in your name and do all the wrong things on your name. So end of the day, who's getting impacted is you, not the person who's doing it, because the identity is being stolen. That's a very, very big problem. So next time when you get any phishing mail where your identity proofs are being asked, don't think it's an innocent scheme or it's a harmless mail. It's a very, very dangerous mail because your identity will be taken and somebody will misutilize this identity. If you are in India, your Aadhaar card, your KYC called PAN number, your voter ID card number, your Aadhaar card number, these can be very, very crucial. So please be very careful before you distribute your numbers to someone. May possible, it's a case of identity theft. Now question arises, how to prevent this identity theft? One, keep all your documents in safe custody. Do not share it with the strangers. And do not ever share it on the mails. You never get mail from the banks. Or you never get mails from the concerned proper institutes who ask on mail to share your KYC, etc. So be watchful to it. If you ever suspect that your identity is compromised, please file a police complaint as early as you can. Get all your checks cancelled which you have issued. Get your cards, debit cards and credit card cancelled because that can be misutilized. And then never ever keep your card and PIN number together. That's very risky. So these are some prevention techniques. If you follow some kind of prevention scheme, you can definitely beat all those consumer fraud. So my suggestion on this is, one, never ever get lured with extraordinary returns. Go steady but go safe. Second, do not share your identity proof with unknown people. Never on mail. Do not disclose your important information such as your identity information, such as your bank details, over telephone. Do not get lured by products on telemarketing schemes. Be careful and please do your research before you order anything. If you just use those small tips, you can definitely not get into the trap of consumer fraud. So that was all about this small session of consumer fraud. I'll see you in the next session for more videos. Till then, I would suggest log on to www.capesh.com for more videos and more quiz questions. Till then, stay tuned. Thank you so much. Take care.